to another episode of Script Unveiled. And I remain your host, DGN Yasharala. You all know that on this show, we are always here to dissect scriptures, basically looking into what is happening in the present state of this world, and we try to figure out a solution from the scriptures. Like we were saying about it last week, remember we said we are embarking on a series class talking about the journey to marriage. And last week, we were talking about the part one of the class, which was titled, How to Identify a Righteous Partner. And today, we'll be proceeding to the next part, but I will not give you a hint of what you'll be expecting. Before we proceed, let us go on a commercial break as we will be right back. Don't go nowhere. It's still your show, Script Unveiled, and I remain your host, DJ Yasharala.
For sponsorship, advert placement, please call or WhatsApp this number, +234 811 731 0928.
I don't wanna lose you now. I'm looking right at the other half of me. The thing I see that's dead in my heart is the space, and now you're home. No. You show me how to fight for now.
You show me, baby.
I tell you, baby, and it was easy coming back.
So, welcome back to the show, and we are proceeding right away. On today's show, it's going to be the part two of the series class. I titled this class, The Warnings. I repeat myself, the warnings that one needs to pay attention to before marriage. I'm sure you're going to be like, why is he talking about the warnings? The thing is this. When it comes to marriage, remember that marriage actually, like we do teachers in school, they will say it is, how am I going to put it? They're going to be like, marriage is an institution. But the fact is this, marriage is a lifetime contract. So the thing is this, before you sign a particular contract, you are meant to go through what that contract entails. So you won't just sign in for something that afterwards you'll be like, why did I even sign that in the first place? Then they will ask you, why don't you go through it first before you sign this particular contract? So the topic of the class is the warnings to observe before going into marriage. And without wasting much time, let us dig into the scriptures. First, we'll start with the book of Tobit. Tobit chapter 4, verse 12. And it says, beware of all whoredom, my son, and chiefly take a wife of the seed of thy fathers, and take not a strange woman to wife, which is not of your father's tribe. For we are the children of the prophet Noah, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember, my son, that our fathers from the beginning, even that they all married wives of their own kindred, and were blessed in their children, and their seed shall inherit the land. Now, this is one of the warnings of marriage. Don't say that because this person actually looks beautiful, looks handsome. Why don't you try your best to find out where actually that person is from? Majority will say, but what does that mean about you getting married? Listen, remember that Yahuwah hates interracial marriage. Let me use that word. Majority will keep saying that Yahuwah. Let me use the worldly terms as they used to call it. Say, God is not a racist. The fact is this, the God that they serve is actually Baal. because God actually means Baal, is actually a racist. Otherwise, he won't paint himself to be white and depict the black people as the wicked ones. But the fact is this, Elohim actually, in some ways, according to what they would call him, they would say that he's a racist. In what way? He deals with a specific people and don't joke with them. Why do you think the scripture here says that you should marry of your own kindred? He wants you to, as Israelites, to marry from your own race. You don't want a case whereby you now get yourself mingled with other race, other people, other heathens, and you end up forgetting your track. Look at the case of Solomon. Solomon gave himself to women to the extent that he started marrying strange women from strange nations. And that was how he lost it. Otherwise, with the wisdom that Solomon had, he should be strong enough to be that king that will still pass on his legacy to his children to come. So here's the great question. Solomon, as wise as he is, who was actually the wisest man that ever walked the earth, but yet he gave himself to strange women. Imagine a king like Solomon having he had 300 wives and 700 concubines. But here's my question for you all. How many children did King Solomon had? If he can have up to 1,000 women all to himself, so how many children did King Solomon had? Only the name of giving himself to strange women. That's a question for you all. You get the answer. So, scripture says that pick a wife of your own kindred. Of your own kindred. Romans chapter 15, verse 4. The book of Romans chapter 15 and verse 4. We are back into the scriptures. Romans chapter 15 and verse 4. That's Romans chapter 15 and verse 4. It says, for whatsoever thing we are written aforetime, we are written for our instruction, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Majority we think that, but that's actually the time of the scriptures. Listen, everything written actually was written aforetime for our own instructions, because Yahuwah, who can see the earth from the beginning, knows that at some point we want to do our own free will. He knew that at some point there will be some crazy things called civilization that will deceive the whole earth and get us into worst sin. Why do you think without the scriptures itself, majority will say count, should I call it homosexuality? Let me use that word. It will still count that as a legal thing. People will see cross-dressing as a good thing on the name of it's all civilization. This is one thing you need to understand. How much more the aspect of marriage? Yahuwah can never be so wicked that he will not give us instructions that will lead us aright. So when the book of Tobit said that you marry of your own kindred, it is an instruction that I've written aforetime to guide us in these recent days. Proverbs chapter 2. The book of Proverbs chapter 2. I'll read from verse 10. This particular verse is for sisters. This particular verse is for sisters. Sisters in the truth who are seeking for a husband. This particular scripture I'm about to read is for you. Proverbs chapter 2 from verse 10. I'll take that from verse 15. And it says, when wisdom enters into your heart and knowledge is pleasant unto your soul, discretion shall guide you, understanding shall keep you, that's to you sisters, to deliver you from the way of the evil man, from the man that speak froward things, who leaves the path of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness, who rejoice to do evil and delight in the frowardness of the wicked, whose ways are crooked and they froward in their path. Reading all these verses, starting about the evil man, talking about him that speak forward things. Now, by the word whereby most men actually, all they care about is, what can I get from this woman? Some of them are so, they are so forward, they are so determined and wicked that they see women only as a pleasure giver. That's why most of these men don't respect our women anymore. Most of these men actually are so forward that all they think about is, anyways, I'm a cute, handsome man. I'm every woman's choice. If I decide to say, let me just try to flow with this girl, I think I can be able to get her or make her to get me a PS5. I can be able to make her to buy me a car. These men actually, they have forward things in their mind. They're all about themselves. They don't care about your soul. So for sisters, when you meet men with these kind of characters, please flee. He's not your husband. He's just a mere man that will come to ruin your journey in life. Because once you go beyond that level of you being friends, if you still get so stubborn saying that, but I love him, I get back to this kind of man who has been forward, I'm telling you, you will blame yourself and regret for the entire rest of your life. Because this man will keep bringing you more pain and sorrow each day. You as a woman, you are actually one of those best human Yahweh have ever created, because you are multitasking. The woman will be the one to be pregnant, to carry the baby for months. You are the same person to deliver the baby, the same person to take care of the house, to cook for the house, to make the laundries, to do things, to do that. Yes, this man is just there claiming that he's the head of the house, and all he do is step out of the house, go to work, say that he work for money, come back home, eat the food that has been prepared, then he goes to sleep. So how does that show you as a good leader? A leader is meant to lead by good example. If you are that man that always do like that, get into the house, eat, take your bath, get out of the house, you don't even care about whatever happened in the house in your absence. These are men that are not worth to be a leader. Because imagine, if this kind of men actually end up giving birth to male children, their sons will get the same character, saying, because my father does do that, that means that's the right thing. Then they make them have that mindset of saying that women actually are apparently slaves, and that's actually wrong. So for sisters, when you meet with forward, wild-mouthed man, please, it's a red flag. Just let him go. It's not for you. Denise actually is going to be speaking to brothers this time around. From verse 16. Proverbs 2, verse 16. I'll be taking it down to verse 20. And it says, to deliver you from the strange women. This is for brothers now. For brothers. Even from the stranger which flatters with our words, which forsake the God of our youth and forget the covenant of our Elohim. Now look at this part. It says, the flatters with our mouth, with our words. So you as brothers, when you meet that particular woman or that sister, who is always a flattering type, not talking about flattering maybe in the truth to it, to eulogize you, know, talking about flat women that are all about flattering, they'll be like, oh, you're so handsome, you're so cute, I just love the hell out of you, I just do this, I don't mind, I just feel like doing this to you, I'm just like doing that with you. Women that are all about, let me just get the best out of him, let me just get the fullest of him, let me just get this, let me just get that. Listen, she's not there to be your partner. She's just there because she wants to please her fleshly desire. She's flattering you. That's why she's flattering you. Look at what verse 17 says. It says, for she forsake the God of our youth. Majority of these women actually are women that they don't have culture. They are women that lack manners. They lack home training. These are women that think that everything that they do outside is the best. So they don't care about what they learn inside. This set of women are women that they forsake the instructions of their youth and they forget the covenant of their Elohim. Elohim actually said in the book of Proverbs chapter 29 verse 9, Proverbs 19:29, that you should not pursue your daughter to be a whore. But the ladies we have today, they don't care. All they care about is, I just need to just find that. I need to just attract every man to myself. Let me be the talk of the town. Let them feel that, yeah, I'm the little Barbie right now. I got the booty on and stuff. These are women that are forsaking their Elohim. Verse 18. For a house inclined unto death. A house inclined unto death. That is, every man that go through those women, you have inclined your soul to death. And apart unto the Raphaim. None that go unto her return again. Neither take they hold of the path of life, that you may walk in the way of a good man and guard the path of the righteous. Now here is it. Why the text suggests that those that go in a way never return? It's true. We have a lot of men who are so rich and wealthy that struggle to become rich in life. But when they fall into the trap of this kind of wicked women, they end up regretting for the rest of their life. That's when you skip hearing, you start hearing some kind of news talking about so-and-so actually has been sold to court by his wife, and now the court is saying that she must take so-and-so amount of his possession and other stuff. This woman will end up bringing you pain. There is no man that will ever go through those kind of women and remain the same way he started. Their life always gets worse. Why? Because those women are just there to drain the best out of you. They are there to drain your career. They are there to drain your future. They are there to drain even your energy. They are there to make your life miserable. But if you are so dumb, you will fall into their trap because of that fleshly lust that you also desire to. Remember that scripture says in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 2. That to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife and let every man have her own husband. It said further that no, that you should deprive not your partner. If it's all about, maybe if you know you can't hold yourself to be celibate and other things, then get a wife. Get one righteous sister, not just a random woman. Because if you're going to get a random woman, she will get you a random problem and random destruction. That's just the whole thing.
Let's step further. Proverbs chapter 5. I'll take from verse 3 to verse 13. And it says, for the lips of a strange woman drops as a honeycomb, and her mouth is smoother than oil. But her end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death, and her steps takes hold on Sheol, that Satan. Lest you should ponder the path of life. Our ways are movable that you cannot know them. They are crafty. These women are crafty. Their ways are movable. Hear me now, therefore, O ye children, and depart not from the words of my mouth. Remove your way far from her, and come not near the door of her house. Like Jesus says in the book of First Thessalonians as well. Is it First Timothy? Where it says, flee from all appearance of evil. Let's keep reading. Verse 10, it says, verse 9. It says, lest you give your honor unto others and your years unto the cruel. Why would they give your years to the cruel? Because she will make your life miserable. That you end up getting yourself into some health mess that might even shorten your life. Verse 10, let stranger be filled with your wealth, and your labor be in the house of a stranger. It's true. Women like this end up actually getting those men into big trouble and requesting for part of the man's sweat and possession. But my question is this,
Imagine if this man end up becoming so helpless that the woman win the case and get part of what he struggled to earn as a possession. These women will still take what they got from that and spend it lavishly on some other bombs outside. That is why I suggested that your own sweat, your wealth, will be in the house of the strangers. And most of these bombs don't even care where the women are making the money from. Then it's all about, let me just sit back at home, play video games, let her go make the money, and she come back here and I spend the money. Verse 11, and you mourn at the last, when your flesh and your body are consumed. And so, have I hated instruction? And say, how have I hated instruction? And my heart despised reproof, and have not obeyed the voice of my teachers, nor inclined my ear to them that instruct me. This is one thing about regret in life. When you want some people, they will never listen. But when things get worse, then they start asking themselves, had I known I should have listened to the instructions? The same way the people of the world were mocking Noah while they was building the ark. But when the rain came, then they were like, we should have listened to Noah. But the thing is this, it was too late already. Why don't you listen to instruction first before it gets too late?
Let's get back into the scriptures. Now, the same Proverbs chapter 5, let me read verse 15. It says, drink water out of your own cistern and running waters out of your own well. This is actually just like, should I say
that is more like a rhetoric when it says drink waters out of your own cistern. It is majorly saying you should get your wife out of your own kindred, from your own nation, not from other nations. Let us look at some critical examples. For example, look at the case of King Solomon. King Solomon practically actually has 300 wives and 700 concubines. But majorly, he took those wives from the other nations and from the nation of Israel. But my question is this, in which I want those that think they are smart to figure it out. King Solomon had 1,000 women to himself. But how many children did King Solomon ever had while he was alive? The same way Jacob had 12 sons and one daughter, that's Dinah. Because I know majority of you might not know that Father Jacob had a daughter. If Yaakov can have 12 sons and one daughter, though he had four wives, how about King Solomon that had 1,000 wives, or 1,000 women to himself rather? How many children did he have? That's a big question. Let's get back to scriptures. Verse 16, let your fountain be dispersed abroad and rivers of waters in the street. Let them be only your own and not strangers with you. Not strangers. He never said go and pick a wife of strangers. He said, let it be of your own, only your own, your own nation. Verse 18, let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the woman of your youth. So that's just it. If you'll be getting married as a brother or a sister, pick from your own nation. Don't say, I know I'm black, but though the camps say the Mexicans are also Israelites, this and that. Listen, the good question is this. Why don't you just pick from your own bloodline? Is it by force for you to just go out there and just keep skipping things? Now, we have some people that will try to say, okay, because is it Puerto Rico? Because Puerto Rico, because the camp says Puerto Rico is a tribe of this, that I want to go get a husband from that nation. Meanwhile, you're dark-skinned. Have you ever asked yourself that the dark-skinned men from your own generation, from your own lineage, are they not there? We have thousands of them. We even have majority of them who are even the truth, and they are very strong and diligent. But because of your love of this interracial thing, you keep going for other nations.
You all might be looking at me that, what's he trying to say? Is it being a racist or something?
Let us see from the scriptures about our forefathers, if they also never want to get married from your own kindred.
Genesis. The book of Genesis. That's Bereshit. Bereshit chapter 28. From verse 1 to verse 3. And Isaac called Elijah Kov and blessed him and charged him and said unto him, You shall not take a woman of the daughters of Canaan. Remember that the so-called nation of Canaan was from the offspring of Ham. And we all know that Ham is a progenitor of the so-called black people, not the Negroes. Because we have the Negroes, we also have the blacks. Don't get it wrong, though we may have the same skin color, but we are from different nations. It has, if you observe, majority of the Canaanites, the descendants of Ham, those are the Egyptians, the Hagarians, the Egyptians, the Assyrians, the people from, most people from Kenya, Kenyans, Namibia, and all those, should I call it, extremely dark and kind of funny nations. Yaakov, Yishak told Yaakov, don't pick a woman of the daughter of Canaan. So why should you pick a wife? Verse 2, arise and go to Padan Aram, to the house of Bethuel, your mother's father, and take a woman from thence of the daughter of Laban, your mother's brother, and El Shaddai bless you and make you fruitful and multiply, and that you may be a multitude of people. Now, can you see that even our forefather Isaac, that's Yeshak, he knew about this so-called trans-international marriage. Let me use that word international, because it's different nations. If I say inter-Russia, the thing maybe I'm talking about the white from the black, you know. Remember that the people of Canaan actually are also dark-skinned, like children of Israel, like the Hebrews. This is Isaac telling his son, Yaakov, don't marry from the daughters of Canaan. So why would you brothers in the truth say that until you go and look for that sister that is as pale as the red man, who is actually going to hang herself under the umbrella of saying, I am from the tribe of whatever, and they can't say that we are from the tribe of Israel. Why don't you marry from your own tribe? Why are you jumping around? If you are Judah, if you are Benjamin, why can't you just marry within your tribe? If you are a brother from Judah, get a wife from Benjamin. Both of you are still blacks. But it would be so ugly for you to say that, okay, I'm from the tribe of Judah, then we're going to pick a wife from the tribe of Zebulun, the one with the blue eyes. If you've heard about the history of the Prussians, you will know where that blue eye came from. But we just started sleeping, they'll say, because the camp says on the 12 tribe charts, listen, pick a wife from your own tribe. It has been an instruction from the right, on the get-go.
If you don't believe that, let's go further. Genesis chapter 24, Bereshit 24, verse 2 to verse 4. And it says, And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house, that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray you, your hand under my thigh. That is Abraham telling his servant. And I will make you swear by Yahuwah, the Elohai of heaven, and the Elohai of the earth, that you shall not take a woman unto my son of the daughters of Canaan, among whom I dwell. Though Abraham was with the living in other nations, but he warned the servants never to give his son a wife from that nation. Look at verse 4. But you shall go unto my country and to my kindred and take a woman unto my son Yitzhak. It has been right from time. So the warning of marriages, don't look at the fact that because of they say, listen, find a partner from your own tribe. Find a partner within your tribe. Don't follow the 12 tribes chart. It's bullshit. Marry within your kindred. Stop jumping around all in the name of, because the camp says, marry from your kindred. Let's go further. Leviticus 21, verse 7. Leviticus 21 and verse 7. And it says, they shall not take a woman that is a whore or profane, neither shall they take a woman put away from a man, for he is holy unto his Elohim. Now, can you say this? The scripture said that if you want to take a wife, don't take a wife that's actually a whore. This is for brothers. Don't go and think that because you get a sister, this and that, blah, 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 that means, listen, prove her. Scripture says that we ought to take a woman that is not a whore or profane. I remember a couple of years back, a particular brother was trying to you want to prove a sister, this and that, but never told me the whole truth. Meanwhile, the truth of the matter is this: he saw the sister actually in the club and picked the sister. Along the line, things actually was exposed, that it was made known that this 24-year-old lady already had 6 children, but she can't give account of why she's not with their father. If it was to be one child, we can say it's by mistake. If it was to be 2, we'll say it's by mistake. If it was 3, we'll say that, okay, maybe it's by mistake. But she had 6 for different men. Automatically, she's a whore. Okay, it was like, okay, fine. Everybody actually might have made a mistake in the past. She might change. Do you believe that in less than a few weeks, this same lady was found back on the club putting on a short jumpsuit, shaking her behind in the face of other men in the club? That's why most times, don't go after appearance. Try to search the spirit of the person you want to take as a partner, because once you go into it, there's no turning back. There is no turning back. First Corinthians chapter 6.
I'll take verse 15 and verse 16.
And it says, know ye not that your bodies are the members of Mashiach? Shall I then take the members of Mashiach and make them a member of a harlot? Never. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body? For two, says he, shall be one flesh. That's why most times we keep saying, whenever you're trying to get married, for brothers, for sisters, be very careful. if you are a sister in the truth, and because of that brother is actually kind of nice in a way, but not in the truth because he's still in the Christian church or in the world. If you get married to him, automatically the two of you actually are becoming one. And don't get it wrong. Everything that is ever clean, once it is joined to anything that is unclean, the unclean will mess up the clean one. Same thing applies to brothers as well. You can be in the truth. If you get married to a woman that is not in the truth, she will end up frustrating your life and get you back into the world. So be careful about the person that you choose as your partner to get entangled with forever in marriage.
Verse 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Ruach HaKodesh, which is in you, which ye have of Elohim, and ye are not your own?
What does it tell us? This is to tell us that our body is not just our own personal property. It is the temple of Ruach HaKodesh, that is the Holy Spirit of Yahuwah, that is actually taking control of our body. So how can you take the temple of Yahuwah to go and get entangled with the body of an harlot? How can you, as a good sister in the truth, take your holy body, your body that is the temple of Yahuwah, to go and get entangled with some wicked men in the world that don't even care about your soul to be saved? That's why you need to be very, very careful with who you choose as your partner.
Before we round up the whole class, let me take this Bible verse, Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 33. And it says, nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his woman as even as himself, and the woman see that she reverence a man.
This is something that you should also discover and observe before you jump into marriage. If that woman you are trying to get married with does not respect you or reverence you to give you that respect that you are due deserve as a man, she is not a wife, she's a woman. She's just sent actually randomly to ruin your life. Because she cannot respect and reference you now that you are not married, she will never respect you when you finally get married to her. Same also applies to sisters. If you see that man that does not love you the way he's meant to love you, if you don't meet that man that will love you the way Yahusha Amashiach love the church, that man will never still love you. Because such men actually are only for themselves alone. So here's my question. How will you feel when you cast all your love on one person and you end up discovering that this person actually don't even care about your soul? How will you feel? That is why most times we tell people, don't go by physical appearance. Go for that spirit that's actually within them. If you as a man, you ought to love your wife the way Amashiach loved the church. Don't be that man that will say, of course I loved my wife. It's not by mouth, it's by action. Have you ever tried your best to see how you can even start making the practicals before you get married? When was the last time that you as a man, you stepped out of the house, you went to work, and you got something for your sister at home or your mother at home? That's a practical. But instead, we have some men that will step out of the house, all they do is to get something for themselves alone and get back to the house and just consider their butt at home. How about women as well? Have you also start working on that practical at home in your father's house? How you can step out of the house and be like, I think there will be some things that I can get here that will be needed at home. Are you that kind of woman that have trained yourself to be like, oh, the time is already getting almost late. This is almost 6 o'clock. I need to get back home and get the house gathered and tidied up before my dad returns back from work. How, if you don't learn all these things by yourself in your parents' house or when you are single, you can never gain that particular attitude or that character when you finally get married. Because like the elders will say in Nigeria here, charity begins at home. Let me just take this verse actually and round up the whole class. James chapter 5 verse 16. James chapter 5, the book of Yaakov, Yaakov 5:16, and it says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now, what do you think I choose this particular verse? If truly you claim to be in a relationship with someone that you want to get married to, you can never tell me that both of you are perfect. At some point, you will definitely actually wrong each other in a way. If you are with a partner that cannot tell you your faults, then I'm sorry, he's not there to help you constructively. Because you might think what you've done is actually right, but it's actually been wrong. As your partner is meant to watch you, she's meant to watch you. Whenever you make mistakes, she's meant to tell you, please, at this point, you actually did something wrong. If that person is actually in the right mind, the person will come to apologize. But if it's that one that you tell he or her their fault, and instead of them to take their fault, they choose to be so arrogant and be like, what do you mean by it? I'm the one at fault. Forget about it. They are not ready for marriage. They are nothing but, in short, they are nothing but a waste product on earth. I do tell some women actually here in Nigeria, I tell them, I said, if you're that kind of woman that you lack manners on how to respect men and also learn how to, if you can cultivate the habit of learning, that is when you can say that yes, you are a wife material. But if you're a woman that all you know is that what it is what you want to do that you're going to do, then forget about marriage. You are not worth to be a wife. Same thing applies to you as a husband too. If you are like, because I'm the head of the house, whatsoever I say is final. Who the hell is my wife to tell me what to do? Listen, the scripture itself said, the book of Genesis chapter 2, when Yahuwah said, he doesn't want man to be alone. Let me make him a helpmate. Your wife is not just there to be a collection in your wardrobe. She was there to join you as a teammate. Because you might see things from this perspective. She might see from a different perspective. Why can't you join hands together and work as a team? Even myself as a man too, I can never say I'm perfect. There are a lot of times I make some mistakes that my wife will tell me, Daddy, at this point, you did something that's actually not right. I'll tell her I'm sorry. Because the word I'm sorry can never kill me. But instead, it will increase the respect and the reputation that I have as a man. But imagine you want to be that egoistic one and be like, who are you as a woman tell me that I'm actually at fault? That means I'm not ready to learn. She as my wife who have been seeing my fault. She telling me because she actually loves me so I can make myself do better. Imagine this kind of men rebuke their wife for correcting them. When they now step out there in the presence of noble men, they will end up disgracing themselves because of their egoistic act. So with all this, I hope you all are able to learn that when it comes to marriage, please and please, please and please, try your best to prove your partner well first before you jump into that marriage relationship, which we call courtship today. If you can go through this class and you observe any of the negative things that I've talked about, please Just let that person go and pray to Yahuwah to give you your own partner. Yahuwah can never be evil. He said in his word, in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 26, verse 1. He says that a good woman is a portion, verse 3. He says, a good woman is a portion to them that fear the Elohim. So you cannot fear Elohim and be righteous, and he will give you a wicked woman. It's not possible. It is only if you foolishly say that, but I love her. Forget about the worldly love. Deal about the scriptural love. Majority will say, but the scriptures is too tedious. It's too that lesson. The scriptures is complete. Why do you think the book of Proverbs chapter 5 verse 19 said to the men, he said, let her breast satisfy you at all time. He never said their breast. So the thing is this, romantically, you as a brother too, we have to your part in the scriptures too. You can't take anything actually just about you being too logical. Listen, if you cannot complete the balance, you are not worth to be a husband. So that's going to be a close for today's show. I pray you all actually learn from today's class. And Yahuwah's will, next week, we'll be talking about another dimension of this journey of marriage. But basically, we'll not start with the women, because some will actually say, why are we starting with the women? I will start with the brothers, because when we men are the head, according to the scriptures, 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 3, it talks about the hierarchy. It said that after Yahuwah is Yahusha, after Yahusha we have man, after man is the woman. So I'll deal with the head first, then I'll deal with the woman afterwards. So next week, catch up with the class, we'll be talking about the difference between a man and a husband, because majority of the men out there are not worth to be a husband. So the question is this, what are the qualities to identify a man from a husband, so that you as a sister can choose a husband instead of you choosing a man to be your head? With this, I say shalom. May Yahuwah bless you. If you have any questions to ask, feel free to text me on my WhatsApp number viewing right here on your screen. And also as well, for those of you who have not subscribed yet to my YouTube channel, endeavor to subscribe, click the bell button so you can keep getting notification as more consecutive videos are being dropped. And remember, a good thing is not for one person. This class is meant to help everyone. So once you watch this class, please endeavor to share the class, tag friends, tag families, let them watch and learn, because we never can tell. No Messiah will jump from the sky to come meet any man anymore. It will send someone to drop a message when other people can help them pass the message across until they get to the right destination. So I remain your host, DJ Nyasharala. I'm drawing the curtain to the end of the show right here as I say, Shalom Wakazak Mashpaka. Stay strong, stay in the spirit. Never let no man take you out of this truth. Endure to the end, because this world is not worth it.